by Barks, the root beer with bite. Wall-to-wall sound and video, the leader in home entertainment. Pizza Hut, making it great. And by 93.3 WMMR, 21 years as the home of rock and roll in Philadelphia.
Hi, I'm John Dadella. Welcome to Making It in Philadelphia. Tonight, a look inside the local music scene to discover what it takes to make it today and what sounds are hot in the area nightclubs. We'll take a personal look at some bands and folks that have already succeeded with Philly as a springboard. And we'll meet some newer local faces ready to break out and make it big.
3 years ago, we were in a basement playing like mostly parties, small parties and stuff like that. Moved on to some frats, things like that. And now we've just been working real hard and getting serious with the whole thing. Buckling down, you know, taking vocal lessons, guitar lessons, stuff like that. And just working to better ourselves as musicians.
Just being real proud of what you do, you know, being able to say, wow, that was great, it was fun, and I feel good about it. You know, I mean, I'd like to have some money while I do it, but, you know, the things that I really like the best, the things that my favorite memories are the things that I never planned for, you know, just the little things that only happen once, they just go by and you got to remember, oh, that's the time, that was cool when that happened, you know.
So you've reached that kind of status where a band as a unit, where five guys have stayed together as five guys for that long, gotten along with each other, and are still rocking and still putting out great albums. That's success. We're a long way away from that.
When we went to Europe, and especially in Japan, you know, there's a real reputation about the city, and they want to know about the Philly sound and all that stuff. So there's a reputation as a music city, but there just hasn't been, for a while, there wasn't the music coming out of it, you know, and I think after the disco thing kind of slowed down, it was time really for rock and roll to come back and take over.
Joining us are local heroes, the Hooters, currently putting the finishing touches on their third album for Columbia Records. Eric, Rob, David, Fran, and John will talk about their new album and about their musical coming of age, from Grendel's Lair, dance parties, to Live Aid and an international tour. We're talking about different perspectives of the local music scene, and one of the most knowledgeable people on that scene is WMMR's very own Street Beat host, Cindy Drew.
Thanks, John. Also in tonight's show, we'll see some live concert performances taped from around the Delaware Valley, where area clubgoers have been treated to some great local rock and roll and national acts, like here at the Barn in Bensalem. And later in the show, a very special visit with former lead singer from the A's, Richard Bush, who's out rocking Philly with his new band called The Candles.
A lot of folks may have seen Richard Bush with the Lion Choir, and of course everyone remembers the A's, but this new band, The Candles, is by far the best band Richard Bush has ever put together. The future is now for five guys from the city and neighboring New Jersey. Hard rockers Heaven's Edge are also featured on tonight's special. This band announced their signing with Columbia a couple of weeks back, and we'll hear from not only the band, but their support people who will help carve a path for their success. To provide their perspective on today's Philadelphia sound, a relatively new group called Dinah Groove, featuring native rockers, will speak about their dedication and dream to provide a party-type atmosphere in the clubs and branch out toward a record contract in the near future. But first, what is making it? The Hooters help explain as they talk about the early days and how they made it as Making It in Philadelphia continues. What is making it? Selling records is the bottom line, and these days what's selling records is videos. Everybody's got one. Rock bands are reportedly spending $100,000, even $250,000 and more to produce these 3.5-minute mini movies. And bands like Cinderella, Bon Jovi, and Def Leppard are benefiting more than any other from the popularity of music videos. Heavy metal or hard rock fans often see and hear the band simultaneously, rather than on the radio first and then in concert as in days past.
Video is very important because the reason you're seeing so many metal bands on MTV is because that's the audience that's watching MTV, and so it's really very important.
Video is critical. Some people believe that's unfortunate. It's taken the place, video, really, of live club gigs. It used to be years ago that when an act wanted to break initially, they'd have to go on like a 150-date club tour to expose themselves to the masses, to the marketplace. Today, in 5 minutes, you can be exposed to millions just on MTV. So it really is critical, and I think that it's critical not only that you have a video, but that the video is something exceptional.
What live bands are competing with now is MTV. And on MTV, bands can do things that they can't do live. And what happens a lot of times, at least with me, all of us are still rock and roll fans. We still go to the Spectrum and, you know, see other shows. And what happens, you see a band on TV and you see all this stuff going on during the video, you go and see them live, and it's a little bit of a letdown. I mean, it's still great, you know, to see a band live, but it's not what you see in the video. When you see a band live, they do a lot more in the video than they do live. And we wanted to try and match what we could do in a video with all the choreography and all the movement and keeping as active as possible.
Kids today and the people today are so used to seeing videos, they've become incredibly critical. I mean, they're like Siskel and Ebert when they look at those videos now. If it's not exceptional, they're not happy with it.
When you were in the A's and now, how does the video age kind of come into play with what you're doing?
Well, when we with the A's, when we got signed, and we thought we were like a TV band, you know, we thought we were kind of like the Monkees or something, real distinct personalities for every guy in the band, and we thought we'd be great on a little screen, and we really wanted Arista to like do videos for us, and Clive Davis just like, he thought the videos would never, ever happen. You know, the video, whole video thing, he said, it's a fluke, it'll never happen.
And this was before MTV.
Well, MTV was just starting, maybe.
Okay.
Or it might have been just prior to MTV.
Yeah.
Yeah, he thought it was just like a joke and it wouldn't happen. And of course, he was right.
Oh, you think so?
No, I don't think so at all.
Darling, fish gotta swim, birds gotta fly, your eyes are blue, so is the sky. Life was so simple when we were kids. Now that we're older, it's more complex.
Philadelphia's own Eric Bazilian and Rob Hyman of the Hooters both grew up as professional musicians as the video age took off and MTV went on the air.
I think our timing was real good. I think we were real lucky because around the time that we put out Nervous Night, MTV and Friday Night Videos, the video medium was really into breaking new bands. They were kind of a cutting edge medium. So we just kind of slid right in there and they were real good to us.
Get the Ten Commandments. Yeah, he's just gonna break him in half.
Zombies was one of the most amazing things that happened to the band, because I don't think we knew what we had, and it's a perfect example of some outside perspective when you can't really see what you're doing yourself. Zombies, we played since our very first gig, and we used to open up in bars with it. We would do it first when there were like two people sitting at the bar and get it out of the way because it was this weird song. But there's something about it that we always liked, but it just kind of held in the background. And then the first real break for us, especially on the radio, was doing a live radio concert from Emerald City, which was one of the late great clubs of this area. And out of that concert, people started requesting All You Zombies, and MMR was playing it. And there was a live version, which we eventually released. And it was a case of popular demand, like people saying, hey, we want this song. And we really didn't know, you know, it was just one of those kind of quirky little songs that we wrote. And then when we got in the studio, the next step was Rick Chertoff also giving some outside influence and saying, listen, we, you know, this song really has potential. And he heard an arrangement where it kind of stretched out and made it more of an epic piece. And it really took some work to kind of pull that out of it. And all of a sudden the song took on this power. And it's stayed with us ever since. I mean, it's probably one of the most identifiable songs we have, and I don't think we ever knew it.
Working on his art, working all by himself.
A lot of times the people say to you, what band do you play? And you say, The Hooters. And they go, the who, the what? And then you say, well, you know that song, All You Zombies? Oh, yeah, I know that song. So they identify with the song for one thing, one reason or another.
Yeah, there was actually even a crossword puzzle and TV guide that somebody sent me. And the clue was, All You Zombies Band, the blank. So I said, all right, we're making now. We're in the TV guide crossword puzzle.
Coming up, more from Richard Busch and a retrospective with the Hooters. Next up, we mention the newest of waves, metal music. They don't look to offend, just to rock down the house. Stay tuned for a homegrown version, Heaven's Edge.
Now, Bruce.
At first, it really wasn't so easy to be a band from Philadelphia. It was very difficult to get the New York record companies interested in us. They would not come down here.
It sucked.
Thank you.
The kiss of death, actually, at the time. I remember there's a friend of mine who was telling me that he played in a band called Radio City, was it? And they had a record out, and he said that they couldn't tell people they were from Philly. People just didn't want to hear them. You know, record companies wanted us to go to New York and play.
And then you go to New York, and the execs wouldn't even go cross town or downtown or uptown to see you, let alone leave the city. You
know? Right. There was no way around.
It was a real catch-22.
But the good thing was the support that we got. You know, Philadelphia has always had kind of this status as a questionable status among the great megalopolis of the world. But, you know, Philadelphians tend to stick together and stand behind their champions. And so we had a real good thing happening here. And I think when we finally did manage to crack the egg, so to speak, we were fueled by that. You know, they stood behind us and they pushed us, still doing it.
How do you make it big? As you heard the Hooters say in so many words, you can't get rich working the clubs, but the exposure can do more than enough. Back in the late 70s, Richard Busch and Rocco Notte were a Philadelphia phenomenon known as the A's. In 81, they had a national top 40 hit off the album Woman's Got the Power, and they still play it in their newest band, The Candles. Richard and Rocco look back with simple pleasure.
When we started, there were only cover bands and disco bands or disco music in the area. And we wrote good tunes. You know, we had great tunes and a great stage performance, and, you know, people could not deny that. And as a result, you know, we got booked here and there and more, and it sort of fed into the thing that was happening nationally and even internationally at that point, 1977, 78.
Were you aware at the time that you might possibly get signed?
Not initially, not in the very beginning. And then then we thought, hey, yeah, let's do this for real. And, you know, we sort of set a goal to be signed in a year, and we were.
What was your initial reaction when you found out that you got a record deal?
I just, you know, I was ready for, like, a new adventure. You know, I just remember sitting out on my porch going, yeah, it's going to be good.
The A's and the Hooters getting signed to record contracts would open the doors for many Philly artists. Recently, WMMR's Rockers host Ray Koob introduced another local group ready to leap into the big time.
We have some guests in the studio tonight on Rockers 93.3 WMMR.
Good evening.
Hello.
Mark, Steve, Reggie, Gigi, and Dave. Heaven's Edge here at the home of rock and roll. A big night for you guys. You have a major announcement to make tonight.
Yes,
we're glad
we
you came to Rockers.
Yes, we do.
And who's going to make it? Mark.
We decided.
That we
Mr.
Were
yes.
Capital. Polly Brothers.
Ray Koob.
Hey, Mark.
He was the first DJ to ever play Heaven's Edge, so we decided Absolutely. To give him the exclusive.
Yes, the big
honor,
like we said before.
Well, there's been rumors up and down, left and right. Every label under the sun has been mentioned. Tell us, for whom will Heaven's Edge be recorded?
Heaven's Edge has decided, after, sorry, all those other labels, we love you, but not as much. Heaven's Edge will become Columbia recording artist. Heaven's Edge. And we could not be happier. I mean,
say it, will you?
Yeah! We could not be. We have been talking to this
Columbia
for so long.
Columbia,
yes,
Columbia.
Columbia.
You can't
Columbia.
Say Heaven's Edge anymore. It's Columbia Recording.
Columbia Recording Arts, Heaven's Edge. So the next time
we
are at the
that.
Empire and you introduce us, it will be Columbia Recording Artists. It just flows
Everybody
off the
say
tongue.
That.
Columbia Recording Artists.
Oh, I love it. Right.
We have never, whether it's here or at the Empire, it is always the best crowd we've ever played to. We play a lot of clubs, like out in Pennsylvania and in South Jersey, that are smaller than this. And we have a good time with them, too. But the thing is, you know, especially when you play a place like this, the Empire is great. We've played there more times than we've played here. But when you play at the Trocadero and you start the set and the people are screaming and the lights come on behind us, a lot of people say, you know, those lights that come on behind us, they're annoying. Because they wash them out and they can't see what's going on. But that for us, that's our rush for the beginning of the show. When those lights come on, we can see the whole club and we can see everybody in the balcony.
Like I tossed
when
great.
Those people have got their arms in the air and they're screaming, that's
the
what makes us through the rest of the set.
That
puts us right through the rest
the biggest
of it.
Rush.
It's our job to manage all of the affairs of the band, whether they be business affairs, creative affairs, and the way we work is we get very closely involved in all aspects of both the business and all the creative elements. We're fortunate in being able to sign with Columbia. We're very fortunate to have the type of deal where we'll be able to have a large portion of the input as far as the creative control is concerned and shaping the direction of the band.
No, I don't like to call us a metal band. I think, you know, just a hard rock band. You know, I guess we play a little bit louder than Madonna does. And a lot of bands get their first break, a hard rock band, they get it on MTV or other video channels because they accept that and they put it in regular rotation. And a lot of bands will go for the visual effect to try and get the name around.
Yeah,
and then,
chance.
You know, once the name is around, then radio stations have a tough time saying no.
Yep.
Basically, and MTV, you know, MTV accepts it before radio stations do. So once the name is around, then you have that many more people calling the radio stations and requesting.
This is a band that is tailor-made for video. Again, in the past, I think that the prime marketing tool was radio. MTV, the explosion of that, we see that MTV sells as much, maybe even more for us from a record company point of view as radio does. This is a band that's tailor-made for the video market.
And, you know, there are bands like, you know, Guns N' Roses and Winger and Cinderella and Britney Fox that they're getting the airplay on radio stations because they got it first on MTV. And that's, you know, I'm hoping that's the plan that we're going to go with. That's what they're talking about now, that we'll be attacking MTV first and then attacking the radio.
Is this a career band, or is it a one-hit wonder? And I think that's what we're talking about. You know, is it a career band? And, you know, we feel very positive about it. There's a chemistry in the band. There's the writing ability, because the songs up at the end. They play great on stage, and they have a great attitude.
Hunger. Hunger makes you write great songs. You gotta rock all the way from day one all the way,
a lot of it.
All the way till you're in your wheelchair.
Right. When Philly gets behind you, they get behind you.
You do a great first album, you gotta come with a great second
album. It's gotta be better.
Yeah, it's gotta be better. You always gotta keep on trying. You know, once you get successful and relaxed, then maybe you won't write as nice songs. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, rock and roll is real finicky, you know, you just gotta, you know, you
yeah, a lot of bands put out one album and then you never hear them again. You know, it's done and it's over.
Heaven's Edge, first and foremost, is an entertaining band. I mean, as a stage presentation, these guys, I think, have it far and away over the majority of the bands that you'll find out there touring. I think that it's enjoyable, it's entertaining. I mean, you walk away from this feeling like you've really gotten your money's worth as far as your juice for your dollar. I think it's basically that all the components fell together, that there's a charismatic front person, plus there's enough of an infrastructure from the band point of view to fall into it. Each one of the band members, if you watch them, there's something there for you to zero in on the eyes. The songs, first and foremost, I think they're there. And I think the key thing is the fact that they're so committed and driven to what they're doing. That's what pushed it over the top.
That's faith.
Right.
This man has faith.
I got this tattoo before the band was signed.
That's right.
That's what did it, by the way. This is permanent.
Thank God we got signed.
It does not wash off.
That's real. They can even lick
it. My mother wishes it would, but it will not come off. This is permanent. So is this band.
Heavy metal or hard rock, as Mark Evans likes to put it. Hey, it's the rage, folks. But you don't have to wander far to find alternatives. When we return, a band inspired by the early successes of the Hooters. Why are these here? Are we expecting Tito Puente to drop out?
How about the issue of commitment? Are there times that sometimes you doubt your commitment?
There are times when you doubt it, when things get rough, but I mean, we love it too much to ever doubt it. We've got too much on the line, and it's just something that we believe in 100%.
You just met Eric Horvitz of Dyna Groove.
Right now on